Welcome to the Digging Deeper podcast, brought to you by New Hope Church. My name is Matt. I'm so excited to dive into today's topic. Before we get there, we're going to go around the room. Jay, how are you doing today, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good, actually. I had a bit of a scary weekend. My youngest fell off the jungle gym and was concussed.
Oh, man.
He got a bit of a concussion and was throwing up, and I was freaking out and called some nurses to make sure I was doing the right thing and testing him rightly. Thankfully, we didn't have to take him to emergency, and he seems like he's doing really well. He's acting normal. He's playing. He's happy. He's doing everything that he normally does. So
yeah,
I think he's okay. Yeah, but that was a bit of a scary thing. Yeah.
That's terrifying. And he's your best one.
Third time's the charm.
Hope the other ones aren't listening to this podcast. That's right.
It's more little Cocos.
Oh, well, I'm glad he's doing well. That's, man, aww, praise God for that. That's good. Lindy, how you doing?
I'm great. I'm good. I've had to make a bit of a mind shift change during this COVID, because I feel like Jay felt a few weeks ago, the PO'd version. Mm. I'm really tired of it. But yeah, just decided that I really need to purposefully just change my mindset and not let this stupid thing get me down. So I'm actually doing really well, and just a renewal of the mind every day, I feel like I need to be doing, which I have been, and it's been going good. So I'm good. Good. I'm hoping the school's open.
Yeah. Oh, you and me both.
We wait patiently for this announcement.
So true. Toby, how you doing, man?
I'm pretty similar to Lindy. You know, we have our days where we go, I am so furious.
Yeah.
And really want church to open up again, and then you go, well, I know why we can't, and it's all good, and yeah, so it's up and down, but personally, I'm feeling good, and still really excited. Mm-hmm. In general, I'm an excited person.
Yeah.
That's good. Don't know if that's coming over correctly, but you hear my heart, you know?
Yeah, you're good.
Excited for what's going on, New Hope, and yeah, just happy to be here, man.
That's awesome. Awesome. Nate, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing better today. I think we all have those days. It sounds like we're in this where you're a little gruntled.
Yeah.
You know, not completely disgruntled, just a little gruntled.
That's right. You're on the spectrum of gruntledness.
Yeah, my son asked the other day when I got home if I needed to wash my hands before he hugged me. I would say that sent me into a bit of a gruntled evening really watching the effect that it's had on my kids. Mm-hmm. And so that's been weighing a bit heavier on me, I'd say, from this weekend.
Yeah.
And that moment was kind of like a sad reality for me, and trying to go like, well, what have I done? What can I do better, you know, to not make my kids afraid to hug their dad or a virus? So that got me gruntled. That's what started it. Mm-hmm. And but I'm really, really happy because today I get to film the 7 testimonies for our baptism.
Boy.
So Steve Enns and I get to hear what God's been up to and try to get ready to share those stories with our church, which I think is just going to come as such a huge encouragement for lots of us who maybe are feeling gruntled one moment or the next. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Tom, how you doing?
Yeah, Monday I walked with my two little grandboys up to the casket for them to see their grandmother. And, a family funeral, our dear Sarah, who does all of our kids ministry videos and so many other ministries in our church as her mom passed away. And it was bizarro because, you know, you couldn't be there. So we hovered in the parking lot in our car, Elaine and I, with snacks and treats, trying to care for our family and greet all the dear people who came to share the love. And it was bizarre. But I'm pretty convinced that God is not messing with us. He's good all the time.
Mm-hmm.
He's in control. God is great. People are crazy. And root beer is good. I think that's a country song. Isn't that something like that?
I think you're on the right track.
You can look it up.
That's right. Awesome.
Cool. How are you, Matt?
I'm doing well. I'm doing well.
You look good.
Thanks. I appreciate that. It's the scarf. I think that's what it is. Brings up my eyes. No, I'm doing really well. We had a pretty relaxed weekend, which was nice. And then, it's been such an interesting season. I feel like I'm back in that place of like learning all the new things all the time, which is my favorite place to be. So I get energized when I'm learning new things and trying new things. And so that's been really fun. So yeah, excited to see what's coming down the pipe in February and into March, and you know, just praying through what does opening up look like when we hopefully get to do that soon, and if not, what does that look like? You know, how do we continue to reach into the darkness, right? And if it's through online, then it's through online, and there's some awesome opportunities there. So yeah, that's where my brain is. I'm excited about it though, so it's good. Man, Jay, your sermon, so good, buddy.
So good. Yeah, I watched it over.
That's right. You did.
By choice.
Five times.
No, it was, you know, I think it was interesting just how relevant. I mean, scripture is always relevant, but culturally, with everything going on right now, this idea of feeling like we're in exile, man, that hits home sometimes. And there's more to it than that. And that's what I want to unpack today a little bit. You did talk a lot about, you know, looking at Israel in the context of them being in exile and you know, God's perspective on that a little bit and our perspective on that a little bit. And that brought up a really interesting question, because I think for all of us, it's safe to say that we've all had times of exile in some way, shape, or form. And I thought it would be interesting to spend a little time this morning kind of going through that and unpacking that a little bit. And so the question I want to actually start out with for everybody is, you know, has there been a time in your life where you felt like you were in exile, and what did that look like for you? I don't know who would like to start that one out. But,
yeah, I got it. I got one on top of my head.
Absolutely.
You know, when there was a time when me and Phoebe were missionaries working for the Bible school in Taiwan with YWAM, and we kind of had this what felt like a perfect storm of constant suffering. We had lost a child to a miscarriage.
Mm-hmm.
Phoebe's dad was having potentially life-ending heart surgery.
Mm-hmm.
And then the leader of our community literally dropped dead while running. And it literally felt just like everything was crashing down on us.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like this perfect storm of events and suffering. And actually, I actually think that was I'm trying to think if that was the second miscarriage or the first miscarriage, because we had two back to back before we had Mira.
Mm-hmm.
And so it just felt like I was saying exactly what I said on Sunday. God, like, where are you?
Yeah.
You know, and because it just felt like if something was going to go wrong, it went wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was, yeah, that was one of the toughest times, I think, for us. And it was, I think it was early in our marriage too, like the first couple years.
Mm-hmm.
So it was tough. Yeah. That was definitely a time where we felt a sense of exile. And I think it was just that what was loudest was that we were going through a lot of suffering and different kinds of suffering, communal suffering, personal suffering, parental suffering. Like it was just emotional suffering. It was a lot of different kinds of suffering all at the same time.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was definitely one time that we felt like we were in a kind of exile. Yeah.
I want to follow that up, and I'll probably ask everybody else who shares too the same question. You had talked on Sunday about holding onto the promise of God that he's always with. He goes through that with us.
Yeah.
You know, what did that look like in your context when you were going through that?
Yeah, you know, I think one of the things that it was, someone said this morning already, like I had to renew my mind.
Mm-hmm.
I've been renewing my mind.
That'd be Lindy.
Lindy. That's what I thought. And I think that was one of the biggest things. Like, we had to keep looking at scripture and reminding ourselves, renewing our mind that God is good.
Yeah.
Like, even when all this is happening, God is still God. He's still good. He still loves us. He still wants our best for us. And so that was something like I think we had to daily just encourage each other with.
Mm-hmm.
Thank God that we were in a very rich community at the time, and so we weren't alone.
Yeah,
you know, we had other people encouraging us. We had other people, like, you know, very similar to like what we do here. Like, we had people bringing us meals, people dropping by to pray for us and just check in. And so, like, it wasn't just us trying to brainwash ourselves in one sense. Like, God is good. God is good. God is good.
Yeah.
No, we saw other ways in which God was good through others, and so. Mm-hmm. That was very significant for us to be able to. I think if it wasn't for that, we might have went crazy.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that was the big thing. Renewing our mind personally, but having community just constantly surrounding us, supporting us, and being there for us.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Lindy, go ahead there.
I think my exile is now.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. All right.
Yeah. It's been a lot of changes. And then to top it off with COVID, it's been, I'm a planner. I like to plan, and I can't plan anything. I haven't been able to plan anything, not even seeing parents, and just trusting God and going and being impatient with him. Yeah. Going, when is this going to end, and when is everything going to happen that I want, you know, to happen? And also going through like a period of just going, I was like, when Jay was preaching, I was like, is this for me? Because I was like, where are you, God? And spending time with him and just really feeling far from God and like going, what is going on? I've been, you know, I'm trying to do, you feel like you're doing trying to do your part, right? And, still feel kind of far from him. And it's just like I said earlier, instead of going this whole time just feeling, oh, you know, this sucks and it's been hard and, you know, when's God going to come through for me, to go, okay, well, let's try and see what I need to learn from this as well. To turn it around and totally go, clearly God is trying to tell me something. He's trying to teach me something, because I feel like before we got here, like a lot of things for here that I felt like I need to deal with, that I felt I was fine. I was like, so emotionally it's been like a roller coaster, but finally stopping, like trying to stop fighting it and lean into it and go, okay, God, what are you trying to tell me? What where do I need to go? What do you need me to do? And it's just been really peaceful since then, since I stopped trying to fight it and just go, okay, this is, what are you trying to tell me? And just actually just get quiet and stop talking and just try and listen to what God is trying to tell me. And I have to tell you, like the life groups and having the services plays a huge role for me. Like our life group is doing Ephesians. We started it last year, but then it was the end of the year and we just started it over, and just going through those things again and the promises that God has given us and stuff, and seeing all of that again is it's like mind blowing. Going, what God has given me, all of this, it's incredible. And so, yeah, definitely the church community is extremely important, and having the life groups and everyone seeing each other. And I know for me, it's been life giving.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Thanks for sharing that.
Absolutely.
Thanks, honey.
Yeah. I can share mine. So would have been, end of our last church, actually. I was struggling with depression, already, and my own mental health and my own, you know, whatever, high school drama, trying to get out of all of that. And so sports was like my biggest outlet. And then our church they fired my dad. And these are the men who called me to be a godly man and wrote me letters about what it looks like to be a godly man. And the people that, as a young man, you kind of look up to and go like, okay, that's what it looks like. I had sleepovers at their houses and stuff. And then they're the same people who lied, backstabbed, and fired my dad. And so that was the a crumbling point of my faith, a crumbling point of what I believed the church to be. I started arguing with God a lot about it, telling him his plan for redemption of the world was stupid. You know,
yeah.
It's always good to tell God that his plans are stupid.
Right.
Idols.
And I just said, like, you know, you're putting trust in broken, flawed humans, so it's just, we're going to lead to more hurt. And so I shared this at Life Group, and it was so interesting. Everyone else kind of piled on right away with their own church hurt. Yeah. It's just interesting about a lot of people, actually, that has been their exile, is because when their faith community, you were talking about how important community is. When that faith community hurts you, and you pull back, or you leave it, or it leaves you, even, you feel more lost, because it's your community, it's where you encountered Christ, it's where maybe you encountered Christ for the first time, or every Sunday, or whatever, and now you're going, what is this? And so, I was angry at God. I was, not feeding my soul with anything good, actually. So I would say that wasn't a time where I pressed into anything good, other than, the only thing I know is I was obedient. I just kept doing what I should have done.
Yeah, amen.
When I didn't want to.
Yeah,
so
that's good.
I didn't want to go to church, but I went.
Yeah,
I hated setting up the chairs and serving at the church, but I did it. At times, I wondered if I was just doing it because my family needed to eat, and this might be my dad's paycheck. You know, New Hope Church. So I've got to go to New Hope Church and set up chairs. Okay.
Thank you, son.
But I would say that the biggest thing in that exile was just a long obedience, even when I didn't feel it, when I didn't see it, even in my serving through my anger and frustration, I just kept being obedient to what God had said. And so sometimes holding on to those promises is like, oh, I want to hold on to those promises because it's going to give me something. And in fact, and in actuality, it might not. It might just be a rough season where holding on to those promises is like, I just need to be obedient because I know that's the right, it is the truth. Yeah. And so I stand on that. And so I have to be obedient. So I'd say that's the community and all that is so interesting because that's actually what led to my exile in that time. I did get baptized years later and encounter Christ in a really cool way and had some friends that spoke into all of that. And I still struggle with what the church should look like and how we need to actually take responsibility of the fact that we're all flawed and not putting people on pedestals and stuff. But anyways, all that to say, obedience was my big takeaway.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Tovi.
Yeah, I think looking back at my life, the times that I felt most in exile, I would have to say it's always been almost kind of self-inflicted. You know, it's by me not spending enough time with God or me indulging in sin and stuff. And then you kind of feel, then that's the only times I've ever felt like, okay, now I'm completely by myself.
Yeah.
And it's my own stupidity in a sense. We've been through stuff, like everybody goes through stuff. And I've always held on to God, you know, and like even, I think one of the worst things we went through is we were part of this previous church and started a company with some of the guys in the church. We had this pizza truck and it was pretty cool. And stuff just went sour and literally like overnight, literally by one call, it was like, okay, you're out and out of the church and everything, like whole community swept out from underneath us.
Yeah.
And we, yeah, we felt like we're in exile, but we also knew this God had a plan. And I always think like with the Egyptians going through the desert, some of them, no, the Israelites, right, out of Egypt. I'm close. You know, I'm sure some of them got depressed and like, oh man, this sucks. They're feeling in exile. And there were some of them were, yeah, well, God's got a plan. We're going to trust him. You know, so yeah, I've always luckily been the positive one. But yeah, there has been times where I go, man, now I'm completely by myself.
Yeah.
And that was self-inflicted 100%.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tom.
Yeah, I can think of a few. One of the exile experiences I think was after one of the kids were born. Elaine went through that postpartum stuff, and it just moved from that to like a full blown clinical depression, and it really I think exiled us socially. We just didn't go places because that was just too hard. So we were out of the social circle. It exiled us in the church, because if we were more spiritual, you wouldn't be depressed. You'd name and claim your victory. And little did people know, you know, how much worship, you know, Elaine was involved in during that time. Like, I'd never seen anybody that immersed in the Lord and in worship. And yet it didn't lift. And one of my colleagues said, yeah, well, you know, my wife's been in that for 35 years and it might never go away. And I'll never forget being on my knees, just crying out to God and just asking one thing, like, is this forever? And, you know, it's funny, one word from God. And it was a small one. Fortunately, it was a 2-letter word, not a 3-letter word. He said, no. And that gave me hope. And, you know, so it went 5 years and it was part of how we got sort of pushed out of the inner circle of the church. Even though I was a pastor, I was no longer part of that inner circle of the church because we were going through that exile. And I don't know if there's a Bible verse for this or if there's a clinical study on this, but my guess is that if you have a good marriage and you go into a crisis, it'll pull you together. I came out of that with more awe and respect and love and admiration for my wife. She never once used that depression as an excuse for bad behavior. But I think also maybe if you go into a crisis in a bad marriage, it could well tear you apart. And I know people right now during COVID, they're fine and they're not engaging online and they're not engaging in a Zoom life group because we don't like it and blah, blah, blah. You're being foolish. Mm-hmm. When things are good, put down the roots.
Yeah. Truth.
Because you have no idea what's coming tomorrow.
Truth.
Yeah.
And you forsake community now, who's going to be there for you mm-hmm. when tough times come down? So, mm-hmm. you know, good times are the times to really, really put down roots. Mm-hmm. To get you through the bad times. Yeah. At least that's a lesson that
yeah,
sort of
that's a good word,
really man. Rang true for us.
Mm, absolutely.
That's good.
I know for myself, I think one of the, the most current, I guess, exile experience was when I was at my last church. And there was a period of about 8 months there of just heavy, heavy spiritual and emotional abuse. I don't know if you guys have ever been in an actual desert. I'm sure you guys have been, Toby and Lynn, you guys have been to the desert.
We have, yeah, even in the desert, right?
So
we're from Africa.
That's right. So when I was in Israel, we got to go to the desert and spent a day in the desert. And it is like the driest, hottest, most terrible, uncomfortable experience of life, I think.
Why
physically.
Is everybody fighting over that land? It's terrible. It's just a desert.
Nobody wants it.
Man, we climbed over a big plateau and I'm going, I don't know what you want, but okay, cool. But you know, it's interesting because when you're in those situations, You only have two options. You either drop dead or you keep walking until you walk out of it. And when I went through that experience at the church, it was very much like that. I came to the end of myself and I kind of had two choices. I either drop dead or I keep walking towards Christ. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where I got to, is a point of just going, I'm here, you know, for whatever reason, and I mean, we can talk a little bit about that in a second, but ultimately, I have two choices. I either drop dead or I keep walking towards Christ. And it was, you know, it was in that moment that, like, that verse in 2 Corinthians, which you talked about in your sermon, about God's grace being sufficient, it's enough, mm-hmm. that really rang true for me. It was in that moment that I realized, you know what, when I come to my end of myself, that's when God steps in and says, all right, I got this. You're finally yes. ready for me to take this.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that's what got me through my exile time, was realizing that I couldn't do it, mm-hmm. But that I didn't have to, right? It was God working through me, and it was amazing. I actually got I resigned from that church and got fired on the same day. It's really interesting. Yeah, I went into a meeting with a letter of resignation, and they went into that meeting ready to fire me. And so it was really interesting.
Did you beat them to the punch?
I did. I Wait dropped that bad boy as soon as I got in there. And then they're like, well, we're going to fire anyway. I said, well, if I resign, you don't have to pay severance. So they went for the resignation. So,
yeah.
Matt.
You still want to leave well, right? Anyway.
Oh, it was so good.
But you know, it was interesting because the next year and a bit, I spent working a secular job. And I thought that was it. I thought, like, this is it for the rest of my life, is work a secular job, and that's fine. But in that time, God kind of gave me a renewed passion. In that exile of not even being a part, you know, of serving in church, God gave me a renewed heart for the lost. And so even in the mix of exile, when I finally gave up and just gave in to God, he actually gave me more passion and more heart for his lost kids. Hmm. And so it was really interesting. Hmm. How that all works. I don't know how it all works. I just know that it works. So, you know, one of the things that I think comes out of that, and I want to ask you guys about this, and I don't know if I have an answer on this, but do you guys think it's possible in the midst of exile to have joy, to find joy in the midst of, you know, that suffering and that pushing and trying to hold to the promises of God? What are you guys' thoughts on that? That's a big question. Yeah, go ahead, Toby.
Yeah, I think just like listening to all these stories and just looking at stories in the Bible, like I always go, like, any kind of exile always leads you towards something
mm-hmm.
instead of you running away from something.
Yeah, yeah.
And we've experienced that personally. Like we know of a lot of South Africans that leave South Africa and they go to a new country or whatever, and they are just depressed and they are unhappy. And we said, we know why it is. It's because they are running from something. They're running away from a country and they're running away from crime or whatever it might be. Mm-hmm. Whereas with us, we weren't running away from something. We were running mm-hmm. towards something, running towards a calling and knowing mm-hmm. that we have a purpose. And I think that's so, always, same with Nate's sermon, you know, the remembering part of it. Yeah. Whenever we go through something, mm-hmm. you know, Lenny actually always, she gets mad at me first. Like, no, I want you to just be sad for a moment. And I just want to go, no, don't worry. I don't want to, don't worry. God's got a plan. We are running towards this. Like, and then I'll name some examples. Remember when this happened and then we ended up here. And if that didn't happen, we wouldn't be able to run towards that. So that's always been my thing. Like, look like at what you're running towards instead of what you're running away from.
Very wise. Really
good.
Thank you.
You guys are just saying some wise things.
Dropping them.
And giving yourself lots of compliments as you say them.
We actually started listening to the sermon.
Oh, there you go. Yeah. That helps. Linda, you are so blessed to have him.
I am. You know.
I like how it sounds, though, when you say something, you go, ooh, that's good. Yeah.
Can't help
one
it.
Of the
if
great,
it's good, it's good. Yes.
One of the greatest joys through my worst times was hugging my children.
Mm.
Yeah.
They don't have any clue what you're going through.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you'd be a fool to tell them.
Mm-hmm.
But to just walk through the door and embrace my children, it was like God was pumping life back into me and energy back into me. You know, being one with Elaine, even though we're both going through hard times together.
Mm-hmm.
And then you find out who your friends really are. And boy, oh boy, though, all of a sudden you realize these are precious relationships. And I'm hanging on to them because they're standing with me. And those are gem learning experiences. And there's great joy in that. Mm-hmm. It gets you through.
Yeah.
I think just to build on what everyone's saying here is that I think the difference of having joy in an exile is perspective. I mean, that's what, like, even what, how God described it to Job wasn't, this is why this crap is all going on, but look how great I am. Let me give you a perspective on my goodness, my glory, my might. And when you get perspective on that, you can have joy. I don't think it's easy. I don't think I am anywhere close to understanding that and gaining that perspective enough. But as PT said, like when, or even what Toby was saying, you get those moments of perspective of remembering this and thinking about that. And it's a broader perspective outside of some of our situations. Cause I think some people honestly feel like they're in exile all the time because the circumstances in their life are what dictate their feelings instead of gaining perspective on what's all going on and that sort of thing. So sometimes it's just like, take a walk, go and actually recount, go back to where you went to school, go back to where you were, like, just think of life in a bit of a grander perspective. And I think there's nothing truer than this than Peter and Levana. I think of who are in our church, if you don't know them, but Levana has had more loss in her life than I know anyone who's had that much loss over and over again, saying goodbye to family members and a newborn nephew and all the stuff she's had to go through, and yet she clings to hope in such an attractive and kind of confusing way. And like, she herself is worried about her own health and that there's fear and worry about that all the time because of some of the stuff. And I'm just always shocked when I talk to her about the hope she has, because she has a different perspective, like she's got this eternal perspective that was forced on her because of the loss. Because like, otherwise, how do you deal with that? What else do you do? So her hope has always been in God and in heaven and in eternity. True. There isn't a hope in this sort of exile now being over and then comfort finally coming. It's no. One day I will be in eternity.
Yeah.
And I think of the funeral this Monday. How does Sarah share that eulogy so beautifully of a hope and a perspective? She's in it. She should be in exile and mourning. You know, she should at least be as gruntled as we are about the pandemic. And there she is sharing a different perspective, which I think gives hope.
You know, it's funny. I think there is a logic to exile. That sounds kind of funny. But, you know, there's different kinds of exile. There's self-inflicted exile, as Tovi said. And I think that's what Israel was being a part of. That is self-inflicted exile. Yeah. And God actually says before he sends them, this is for your good. I'm doing this for your sake. You know, and then there's other kinds of exile which you have absolutely no control over. That's either a result of the brokenness of the world and of human bodies, or it's the sinfulness of other people. But the logic still remains. You know, we quoted the passage, my grace is sufficient for you. No matter what kind of exile you're in, the logic is this, if you let it, will draw you closer to the source of joy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the joy of the Lord is my strength. So your joy is not in circumstances, Nate said wonderfully there. Your joy is in knowing the source of joy, and that God loves you, cares for you, has your good for you. Mm-hmm. Everything of his disposition and posture towards you is pure goodness. So how could you not have joy? I love the way that Dallas Willard says how he defines joy. It's a pervasive sense of well-being, knowing that it's all going to be okay, mm-hmm. no matter what circumstance. And so I think if that's the case, you absolutely can have joy
mm-hmm.
in exile.
Mm, absolutely. Guys, thank you so much for sharing from your lives today and some of the experiences you've had. And I hope to our listeners, this is an encouragement and a reminder that God is good. And he's bigger than all this stuff, and that it is crucial to hold on to that perspective. And that's why we need community. That's why we need each other. That's why we need to be connected, you know, either online or in person or whatever that looks like. So I encourage you in that. And if it is your first time or you want to get connected, jump on our website, jump on our app. We've got a connect card. We would love to connect with you and be an encouragement. We'll talk to you next time on Digging Deeper.